it is right now. Okay, so first let me introduce myself. I'm Luca Conversi, the Herschel SPIRE calibration scientist for the photometer. Give you two presentations. Try to be quick on this. The second one is a presentation I basically gave in the last webinar. I don't know if any of you already attended last time. It's about how you should do photometry with SPIRE. And the first one is mainly an introduction on improvements that we have in HIPE 10 pipeline for SPIRE. And then we will have two or three demos, depending on if you have time and if you're interested in all of them. And okay, we will see them later. So let me start with what's new in HIPE 10. I will not go into the details of all of this. The main things that we improved in HIPE 10 is that we have a new definition on level 1. As of HIPE 9, the destriper is the default map maker. But until HIPE 9, the level 1 data still included the so-called DC component. So each detector had a different baseline. In HIPE 10, what we did was to remove this baseline. So basically, the new level 1 is the output level 1 given by the destriper. We also have a new level 2 products. So up until HIPE 9, you only had three maps for the three wavebands. And these were calibrated for point source and in units of Jansky per beam. In HIPE 10, together with these three maps that we changed name to PS, RC, PLW, PMW, PSW, we included three maps calibrated for extended emission, where we also add the absolute offset as derived from the cross-calibration with Planck HFI maps. And I will go into the detail of how we do that in the next slides. And for solar system objects, we also include maps that are in the SSO REST frame. Other things is that we updated the beam areas calculation. This is reported in the SPIRE data reduction guide, and I'll tell you later where you could find the new values. And also the color correction values changed. And changes significant. We're talking about 5 to 10% changes. So you are invited to use the new values. Let me see if I forget anything. Okay, yes, then we also, of course, improved the photometry consistency among all source extraction and photometry tasks. And the other thing that we added is that since... Yes, sorry? Okay. We also added the diagnostic product, which is an output of the destriper, and which help users to understand if the destriper converged, if there is anything wrong. So you can check this product to understand what the destriper did in the automatic pipeline. Well, in the next slide, that's...
Wait, just one question, Luca, because you did not talk or didn't get it about the Planck offset.
I will go to this into this later.
Okay.
So this is just a summary, just to tell you that now you will basically have two sets of map, one calibrated for point source in Jansky per beam without any offset. So these are the map that we provided so far. And we added another set of map in mega Jansky per steradiant with an absolute offset derived from Planck maps. And I will go into the detail of how we do that in the next slides.
Okay.
Well, this other slide is to go into the details of other minor changes, so I will just think I'll skip it, just for you to check. Here, well, this is the outline of what the photometer pipeline is from level 0.5 to level 0.2, to level 2. That's basically identical to HIPE 9. The only main difference is, as I told you, is the new level 1 product, that basically the destriping until HIPE 9 was taking place after level 1, so between level 1 and level 2, while here the destriping is taking place before generating the level 1. So the level 1 product will contain destriped timelines, which makes easier, for example, if you just want to change the WCS of your map, you don't need to rerun the baseline or the destriper. You just take the level 1 and you produce the map with a different WCS. So should be much faster. Or even if you want, or even if you want to mask some data, and I have a demo on this later. That's what I was telling you earlier. So that's the new level 2. In previous HIPE version, you only had 3 maps. Now you could see that it's much more populated. So you actually have a total of 12 products here. The product that starts with PSRC is our maps calibrated for point source. While if it starts with EXTD, are the maps calibrated for extended emission. And on top of these six maps, for each map we also have the diagnostic product, which is the outcome of the destriper. So the point source calibrated map are done exactly in the same way as we did in HIPE 9. So you just produce the level 1, you destripe your data, and then the output of the destriper is the PSRC map. To go from the PSRC map to the extended emission map, what we do is that we go back to the destriped level 1. We apply the relative gain correction, and I will tell you later if you don't know what it is and why you need to do that. Then we run the destriper on this modified, let's say, level 1 data. And then the output map will still be in Jansky per beam. So we divide these maps for the beam area and convert these maps in mega Jansky per steradiant. And we always stay under the assumption that throughout all our pipeline that nu f nu is equal to constant. So if you assume that your source has a different spectra, you need to apply color correction. And then the last point, so basically the outcome of these 3 points is that you will have a map which is in mega Jansky per steradiant, but you still don't know what's the total offset of the map. So to do that, we cross-calibrate with Planck. And in the next slide, I'll show you how the algorithm works. Well, last point, which is not shown in this plot, in this image over here, is that if you have an SSO observation, as I told you, you will have another set of 3 maps in producing the rest frame of the solar system object. So now I have a couple of slides on how you can on how this cross-calibration with Planck works. So we start from either the PMW or PLW map, so a 350 or 500 micron map. The first thing we do is to expand the map in order to avoid edge effects, and then we convert this map with an 8 arc minute Gaussian beam, which is the beam present in the Planck HFI maps. And so what you get out of it is a convolved spire maps. Remember that we already divided by the beam area, so it's a convolved spire map in mega Jansky per steradiant, where you don't know the offset. Then we have a set of 2 full sky. Then you have a set. Then you have 2 full sky maps from Planck at 500 micron, 350 micron. So these 2 maps are have more or less are at more or less the same waveband of Planck of Spire. Sorry. The first thing we do is to extract the portion of sky that is that corresponds to the Spire observation, and we compute a ratio map. Now I told that these two Planck maps are at more or less the same frequency of Spire. The point is that it's more or less, so we need to apply color correction to go from the HFI central frequency to the Spire frequency. So this color correction is calculated under the assumption that we assume that all over the sky we have a gray body with a fixed beta equal 1.8. So that's an assumption. Again, to go from the HFI 857 map to PMW, the color correction is really small. We are talking about 1 or 2%. While the effect is stronger for to go from HFI 545 to PLW, because the offset between the filter bands is higher, and so here the color correction is typically of the order of probably 7 to 10%. So the outcome of this is that we have a ratio map from the two Planck bands. We have a color correction table where we know for each pixel of the map we calculate the ratio between the two Planck maps, and we can estimate the color correction to apply to that pixel. And this basically gives you as an outcome a color corrected HFI map, which you can compare directly with the Spire map. This is explained in the next slide. So you have a convolved Spire map, as I told you earlier, and this color corrected HFI map. The first thing we do is to compute the difference between the two, and then to compute the average of the difference. The average of the difference is what we use as the first estimation of the offset to apply to the Spire map. So we go back to the high-resolution unconvolved Spire map, and we apply this first estimation of the offset. Then we embed the Spire map into the Planck one with the actual offset, and we recompute the convolution in order to avoid edge effects. And then basically what you get is an embedded Spire map convolved again with the Planck beam, and you can compute again the offset, so the difference between the two maps, as a second iteration. So after these two iterations we calculate the total offset, and that's added to the Spire map, and it's also reported into the metadata of the map. Together with the total offset you will also find the standard deviation of the difference map, so that this will tell you more or less what is the expected, I mean, what is the variation in your map. So this is valid for the 500 and 350 micron bands, where we have a close correlation with Planck. For the 250 micron band, we apply the same algorithm, but of course we need to extrapolate our gray body function to 250. So in this case, the results are much more model dependent. Unfortunately, Planck maps are not public yet, so users are not able to replicate this step. Although all the task is present into HIPE 10, without the Planck maps you cannot run it. Once Planck maps will become public, you will be able to run this step, and so you can also apply the gray body function that you prefer. So I don't know if you have questions on this. And the next slide unfortunately, I need to show you like this. So you start from, this is an example of what the algorithm is doing. So you start from the SPIRE map. This is an observation of Huygens, the galactic plane. Then you convolve with the 8 arc minute Gaussian beam. And you could see it here at the edges that there are some dark areas. Then you could compare this convolved SPIRE map with the Planck map. Unfortunately, this is a simulated map because, again, I cannot show you the original map. But you could see that there is a nice correlation, that nice agreement here in the center. But the SPIRE convolved map is darker here at the edges. It's darker here in respect to the original Planck one. But anyway, the first thing is that we compute the difference between these two maps, and this gives you a first estimation of the offset. Then what we do is to sum this offset to the SPIRE map, and we embed it on the Planck one. And we convolve again with the Gaussian beam, with the 8 arc minute Gaussian beam. And this is the result now. So this is the SPIRE map embedded plus convolved. And you could see that there is now a much better agreement, and that the dark regions that were present at the edges of the SPIRE map are not present anymore, and that's because it was just an edge effect. You could still see here that there is some discontinuity. That's mainly because the SPIRE map from that was the starting point was a single scan parallel mode observation. So the destriper is not working at its full capability. If I take the scan and cross scan, then you would see an even better agreement between the Planck map and the SPIRE map embedded into Planck. So I hope you understand what the algorithm is doing. And then I will continue. Another thing that we have in since at least HIPE 6.1 is...
Wait, Luca, yep. If you go to another topic, one small question. Do you know the timeline when the Planck maps are public? So that this algorithm
they have a conference in mid-April or beginning of April, but Planck maps should be made public even earlier. In principle, should become public in a couple of weeks or 1 month.
Okay.
But it's not up to us.
Yeah.
And then the Planck maps that we are using in our pipeline are a little bit different because we are using, as I said, we are using a beam which is an 8 arc minute beam, Gaussian beam. Planck maps have a higher resolution. They are at between 4 and 5 arc minute, but their beam is not Gaussian. And actually, it's not constant along the sky. So we still need to verify if we could use their full resolution maps, because otherwise it would be too complicated to use a beam which is not the same for all observations. So what I'm basically saying is that at the moment I cannot guarantee that you can take Planck maps out of their archive and use it as they are with HIPE. But we will work on this in the next weeks.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay. So, well, this is just to mention, I don't know how many people know that, we have level 2.5 which is generated automatically in many observations. This is just a concatenation of all observations belonging to the same program that are contiguous. Unfortunately, due to the fact that from time to time observations are really huge, we cannot use the destriper. So at the moment, this is just a kind of mosaicing. So probably they are not best maps to be used for scientific purposes. And again, that's something we are going to improve for HIPE 11. But one of the demos, if people are interested, is to show how you can merge two parallel mode observations together and then run the destriper.
Yes, I'm very interested in that.
Okay.
Actually, awesome. I asked because we have, data which was taken in order to compensate for saturated pixels in parallel mode.
Yeah. And, okay. So you could apply exactly the same task I'm using. Just on not, I mean, you can also merge, of course, large maps, small maps. So. The script I will show you, you could use for your scientific case.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
The next thing I wanted to show is, well, which are the typical cases in which you need to reprocess or modify your data. I would say the most common cases are either you are observing, your observation took place around the cooler bar. So for people who don't know, every time we need to observe with SPIRE, we need to cool down the instrument. That's a so-called cooler recycle. However, after the end of this process, the temperature of the instrument is not really stable. So if your observation takes place between 6 and 8 hours after the cooler recycle, it may well be that you see stripes in your map. Well, this is especially visible if you're observing extragalactic fields in large or parallel mode. If it is small maps, you will not see the drift because the scan is too fast. Basically that's all. So here you could see what I'm showing is two observations of exactly the same region. But one is done when this cooler bar, the temperature of the cooler increased rapidly, and so you see stripes left over because the pipeline is not able to correct for this effect. While the other observation is taken when the temperature is much more stable, and you see that there are no stripes. So in this case, the simplest thing to do is to use a higher polynomial order. When you use the destriper, usually the standard call is to use a polynomial order equals zero. So it's just trying to remove a median. You could use, for example, polynomial order equal one. So it tries to do a linear fit. Bear in mind, of course, that if you use higher polynomial orders, you may start to remove real data, real structure. And the other effect that may be visible in few observations are glitches which are not efficiently removed by the pipeline. And so the solution here is either to use alternative deglitchers, or while, for example, we have the sigma kappa deglitcher as a second option, while the standard one is the wavelet deglitcher. Or you may try to look into your data, into your level one data, to identify what is the bolometer which is producing the glitch. And that's one of the other demos I'd like to do with you today, if people, of course, are interested in this. This is just to mention, if this is your first time, you are approaching SPIRE data, you have in the menu, if you open HIPE under pipelines, SPIRE, you have all the list of photometer user pipelines. These are also well described into the SPIRE data reduction guide. And if you open one of these, the only thing that you need to do in order to reanalyze your observation is to enter the obsidy, the pool where it is, if you have it in your local store, in your hard drive, and eventually an output directory if you want to save the output maps as bits files. Then you have a set of options present here, and this is basically the kind of map maker you want to use. We have the naive and mud map. We are suggesting, we are telling users to use the naive one, and mud map is going to be deprecated soon anyway. You could choose to include turnarounds. That means that include data taken when the spacecraft is moving from one scan leg to the other. Over there, the speed is not stable, so you may have noisier data affected by 1 over f noise, but this enlarges the observed region. The next step is if you want to apply extended emission gain correction, and I will tell, and this is needed if you are interested in extended emission, or if you're interested in doing aperture photometry, and I'll go back to this later. The next two are basically if you want to use either the destriper or the baseline subtraction. So usually you should put either one to put to false or true, one of the two, not both. And the last one is the cooler barb detection. So this is not on by default because it's still in beta testing. But if you turn it on, in principle, the pipeline should be able to find if your observation is affected by cooler barb and try to apply a correction without using a higher polynomial order. The other menu that is present in HIPE is the SPIRE Useful Script menu under the Scripts menu. And we have few scripts. One is the, well, I think that the names are self-explanatory. The only one that I'd like to show is the bolometer finder, which is very useful if you want to identify glitches in your data and remove them. And the last but not least, we also have a nice plugin to HIPE that you can download from this address. And this is basically a GUI interface to the pipeline scripts. So you can analyze and reduce your data without knowing anything about coding in Jython and just using this GUI. So that's all for this first presentation, unless people have questions. Okay, then I'll go through the second one. Can I do like this? Yes, this works. So the second one is on how to do photometry with SPIRE maps, and that's basically the same as the same presentation as I gave the last webinar in October. So as I mentioned earlier, SPIRE maps by default are calibrated. Well, SPIRE data is calibrated on Neptune, and it's calibrated under the assumption. Well, it's calibrated with point source extraction in mind, I would say. This means that map units are in Jansky per beam, and that the peak value corresponds to your flux density. And also, the pipeline works under the assumption of nu f nu equal constant. So basically, again, you need to apply color correction if you know that your source is different. So if you want to do source extraction of point sources, you have different tools available in HIPE. You have the annular sky aperture photometry task, and this does aperture photometry, and this is not recommended for point sources in general. What we recommend is to use either the SAS extractor or the timeline fitter. On top of this, you also have DAOFOT and eventually Gaussian fitting. So here I list all possible tasks that you have to extract sources. Well, okay, this slide explains you the details on how the SAS extractor and DAOFOT extractors work. So then I will just skip it. Well, DAOFOT is just like IDL Astrolib, and SAS extractor is an implementation of the algorithm described by Savage and Oliver. Just to mention that these two extractors, they work on the map. So you can just putting some values like threshold, you don't need to know where the sources are. The timeline fitter instead, it works on level 1 and it performs Gaussian fit to the data. So to work, you need to provide the position of the sources. And the typical case is that you could run, for example, the one source extractor to identify sources, and then the timeline fitter to get the best possible estimation of the flux of each source. The other solution is to use aperture photometry. This works only for one source at a time. The advantage is that you know visibly which annular sky region you are using to estimate the background. The disadvantage is that you need to convert maps from Janskeeper beam to Janskeeper pixel, for example, and to apply aperture correction. And of course, all of these operations means that you are adding more uncertainties in your estimation, because beam areas are known at 4%, so you are adding a 4% uncertainty. So this is a table where it shows you what are the different, the required inputs for each algorithm. Basically, you could see that SAS extractor only needs to define the full width of maximum for each waveband and the detection threshold. While for DAOFOT, you also need to provide the beam area and apply an aperture correction. The timeline fitter only needs to know what is the inner radius where it will find the peak, which are either 22, 30, 42 arc seconds, and then the torus. So in this sense, it's very similar to aperture photometry. The difference that if you run the aperture photometry task, again, you also need to apply the aperture correction, which you don't need to if you use the timeline fitter. That's also a table which is given in the data reduction guide, which is telling you what is the suggested methods for each case. So if you're interested in Poisson's photometry and you don't know where your sources are, then you should use SAS extractor or DAOFOT, but we suggest SAS. If you already know where your sources are and they are bright, then the suggestion is to use the timeline fitter. If the sources are not really bright, then it's better to use SAS extractor because it estimates better the flux. The last case is instead if you're interested in extended source photometry, you must use the annular sky aperture photometry. So here are three plots that are comparing results between the different the different methods. See that there is some dispersion. Usually the dispersion is the level of 5 to 10%. It really depends. With the aperture photometry is the one which is, well, you see that SAS extractor and timeline fitter usually agree very well, while DAOFOT and aperture photometry task from time to time just give different results. This is for PSW, and then it's the same, very similar for PMW and PLW. Of course, things get worse as you go to higher wavebands because of the lower resolution. Again, this is these are some results that we from the SPIRE ICC, where we compare results between the different tasks, and we see that basically SAS Extractor and Timeline Fitter agree pretty much. They agree within 3 to 4%, while aperture photometry usually tends to give a larger flux. Since SPIRE calibration has been done using the timeline fitter, that's our benchmark. So that's why we say that the timeline fitter is will give you the best estimation of your source flux. So once again, that's what I was telling you, that we recommend to use the SAS Extractor for source extraction and the timeline fitter for photometry of all but the faintest sources. There is one disadvantage in using the timeline fitter, that since it's working on level 1 data, if you have really big observation, it will take quite some time to read and search the sources into your level 1 timeline. So once again, if memory and time is constrained, I suggest you to use the SAS Extractor, which is working on the map, so it is way faster. Again, we claim, we still claim a total of 7% uncertainty for point source photometry. This comes from mainly from a 5% absolute level of net, so from a 5% error uncertainty on the Neptune model. On the previous presentation, I forgot to tell you that for extended emission we claim an uncertainty of 15%, because on top of this 2%, which is statistical reproducibility, and 5% on Neptune model, you need to add a 4% on beam areas uncertainty, and roughly 5% on Planck uncertainty. So again, we are at 7% for point source, 15% for extended emission. And the last topic of the talk is how you do photometry for extended source. Just give me a second. So usually what you do is, especially if you have observations reduced with HIPE 9 or earlier, you need to take the level 1 data, apply the relative gain correction, and eventually add the turnaround data. Then you need to rerun the destriper, rerun the map making, and then you need to convert maps from default SPIRE units, which are Jansky per beam, to mega Jansky per steradian, for example. However, with HIPE 10, these first two steps are not needed if you start from the already extended emission calibrated maps that we call now EXTD-PXW. Then you need to carry out aperture photometry on the image and apply the extend source correction, and eventually the color correction, which you also need to apply for point source. So why do you need to use this relative gain correction? As I mentioned, SPIRE calibration is based under the assumption of point source. So what we do is that we equal that when we observe Neptune, we put all the peaks of all the bolometers at the same value. So basically, we are equalizing the peaks. However, each bolometer has a slightly different full width of maximum, slightly different beam area. So when you're interested in doing aperture photometry, what you need to equalize is not the peak, but rather the solid angle, the beam area. And that's basically what this relative gain correction does. And this is clearly evident in this plot. So if you are doing timeline fitting, which means that we are using level 1 data, and you apply no extended gain, you get a nice fit of the Neptune flux around. So you see that most of the this plot basically is showing you how many detectors fall into the same beam of Jansky and for a Neptune observation. So if you see that if I'm using a timeline fitting, I have that most of the detectors are within this more or less Gaussian region, which is centered at 158 Jansky for Neptune. If I do the same timeline fitting applying the extended gain, you see that the same results are spread all around. So there is no clear indication of what is the Neptune flux in this case. However, if I do the aperture photometry, the situation is reversed. So if I don't apply the extended gain correction, you see that each bolometer is giving you a slightly different flux estimation of Neptune. While if you apply the extended gain, you see that, okay, yeah, it's not as nice as earlier, as before. That's why we are telling you to use timeline fitting for point source. But again, that's a broader Gaussian centered around 158. So I hope this explain you why you should use extended gain correction if you are interested in extended emission, or generally speaking, if you're using aperture photometry. And if you're looking at point source or interested in a point source, it's not worth to go into this mess of applying gain correction and changing to Jansky per steradiant, mega Jansky per steradiant. So just use timeline fitting. That's the outcome, basically. Also, to convert point source maps from Jansky per beam to mega Jansky per steradiant or Jansky per pixel, there is a nice convert image unit task. So you just need to provide the new unit, which needs to be, again, mega Jansky per steradiant or Jansky per pixel, and the beam area. Beam areas were provided in the previous let me see if I find it. Yeah, were provided here.
In the other presentation.
So it's, for example, for PSW it's 465 now. While, sorry, I forgot to update this plot. Well, you see in this image, this 423 was the older value. So you see that there is a difference of almost 10% between the old beam area and the new one. Okay, once you apply the relative gain correction and you convert it into surface brightness, then you can run your aperture photometry. And then you need to multiply your result by the aperture correction, which again it's listed in the previous table or in the SPIRE data reduction guide. And you also need to multiply the map by the color correction for extended emission, and this is explained into the demo that we will do later. You need to do that basically because the and this plot is shown the SPIRE filter profiles in the three wavebands. So blue is 250, red is 500. But when you are observing an extended emission, then you need to take into account the fact that the beam is not constant in your waveband, and this affects basically the filter transmission, if it is point source or extended emission. And last thing you might need to do is to apply color correction in case you are using in case your source is not new f, does not respect the spectrum new f nu equal constant. Last slide. Okay, this is further help. So basically, all of the most interesting thing is to have a look at the section 5.7 of the SPIRE data reduction guide, and here you could see the summary of all this presentation, and it's it should explain you, I hope pretty well how to do photometry with SPIRE. Any other question?
No.
Okay. So I want to move on to the demos that I have for you. The first one is, since you told me that you're interested, I've prepared, it's available on the, as these two presentations, also these two of these scripts are available on the wiki page. So the first one is what the title of the script is webinar_sphot_merged_striper.python. So what the script does is to take two parallel mode observations, which are these two. You can add as many observations as you want inside this object, which is a Python list. So the first thing I do is to define this list of ops IDs. And I also define an array, PLW in this case, because later on I do some calculation just for the PLW array. Then I load my calibration from my local hard drive, but you could load it also in other ways, like from the HSA or from the observation. So if you don't know how to do that, let me know. I don't know what is your level of knowledge. And then I load this definition of relative gain correction. Then I define just these two variables. And then I have a loop. This is a loop on the list of ops IDs. So in this case, it's just two objects. And what this loop does is to read the observation from the HSA. You can also change it to read it from your local hard drive, of course. And then in the first iteration, it just put the observation level one inside the product scan lines, while in the second iteration in the following iterations, what it does is to append to this product scan lines all the other level ones. So basically, when you merge two observations, what you do is to merge the level one from all the observations. In my case, this will not work for you, unfortunately. I'm also reading the level. The two observations that are present into the script at the moment are are done are present into the archive and they are public, but they are reduced with HIPE 9. While I also have them reduced with HIPE 10. So, for example, I have access to the extended emission map reduced with the offset obtained from Planck. So what I'm doing in this script, it's basically reading with this line here. What I do is to read the metadata of the map calibrated with Planck. And what I'm doing is saying, okay, and the first observation, tell me what is the offset that's been computed. And then I do the same for the next observation. So basically what I'm trying to do is I want to take these two parallel mode observations, merge them, run the destriper, and then have an estimation of the offset as computed by the standard pipeline when comparing with Planck. So what I do is to take the offset from each observation, and then later on you will see that I will compute the average of these two offsets just to have just to have an estimation of what is the offset of the combined map, which again you cannot do unfortunately because you don't have SPIRE data, Planck maps. So now I'm running a loop.
But Luca, one question: if you have data from version 10 in the archive, you would not need to do this step, or
no, you need, because so far. So the pipeline works on single observations at the moment. So you will have Planck, you will have extended calibrated maps
for each of the
two. Okay. So what I'm doing right now is to merge them together and convert them again into Megajansky per steradiant.
Okay.
But then you will not have the offset, because that's the next step that it's missing.
Okay.
So what I'm doing is to take the offset from the original observation, compute the average of the two offsets, and then apply
to the final map. Okay.
Which is not entirely correct, but it's better than nothing.
Yeah. Okay. So the
one question for me also, Luca. Normally the script applies for parallel mode observations if you have the nominal and the orthogonal observation, I guess. I mean that's how I would apply it immediately. But in this case, the offsets are the same, no?
Well, not really, because the point is, of course, the Planck portion of the sky is exactly the same. What changes is the estimation of the SPIRE map, because one map has been observed in one direction and the second map has been observed in the cross-scan direction. So there are some variations in the way that this striper reconstructed the map. I can show you very...
Yes, but I talk of Planck, because Planck is covering always the same area.
Yes, Planck is... Well, what we do is basically compute the difference between Planck, which is always the same, minus SPIRE.
Mm-hmm.
But the two SPIRE maps changes a little bit.
Yeah, yeah.
Little bit, I show you here. This is the offset parameter. So you see that in the first iteration is 4.86 megajansky per steradian. That's the offset computed in the first observation. In the second observation is 4.63. Mm-hmm. So we are talking about a variation of 5%, if I'm not wrong.
Mm-hmm. Because these are two observations in your example script here are in fact parallel mode observations.
Yes, these are two parallel mode observations. Yes.
Okay, I see.
So they are covering exactly the same region of sky. One is one direction and the other one is
the other.
Okay. So after at the end of this loop, what I have is this product, which is scanline product here, which contains all the building blocks from the first and from the second level one. So you see that there are 38 products in total. Well, in the original map, probably there were 19 each. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So the next thing I do is to apply the relative gain correction on this merged level one product, because I'm assuming we are interested in extended emission. While this is running, I'm going to take some water. Once again, the SPIRE data structure is the same in all observing modes. So you can use this script also to merge a large map with a small map, or a parallel mode map with a small map, for example.
Mm-hmm. I know, but there's one point which is not working. For example, if I have a large map with saturated pixels, I need to get rid of the saturated pixels before I merge with a smaller map that compensates for that.
No, because the saturated pixel is already masked in when you run the levels from level 0.5 to level 1. Saturated data is already masked, so it will not enter into the calculation of your map.
But that's new, because in earlier HIPE versions, the saturated pixels, yeah, they had non-values, yeah, okay. I see.
Mm-hmm. Or at least, I suggest you to try, and if that's not the case, let me know, because that's a bug in the software. But saturated pixel mm-hmm. should be, well, are excluded from the calculation. And if they're not, then mm-hmm. that's a bug.
Okay, so, yeah, good to know.
So now what I'm doing is to run the striper. I just copy, by the way, this script that I'm providing you is just basically the script provided under SPIRE useful script menu, where you have the SPIRE map merging script. And the only thing I changed is to add this lines here. So I added the application of the relative gain correction and the destriper, and these lines are taken from the standard pipeline script here. Mm-hmm. So it's not anything really complicated, in the sense it's already available, so it's just copy and paste from a couple of scripts. The whole point that you need to understand is that when you want to merge two observations, the only thing that you need to do is that you need to basically attach together two or more level one products. And then the destriper and does all the rest. So now I have I've run the destriper. And let me run these three lines. So the outcome of all these operations is that I have a map org variable, which is this observation here, and I have map merged variable, which is this other one. So you see that this is including the two scan and cross scan, and that's just one direction. Know what I did, but anyway. Okay. Now, if I proceed with my script, now I want to convert maps into megajansky per steradiant, and I assume, as the pipeline does, that my that my map is in that my source is as a spectrum alpha equal minus one, so nu f nu is equal constant. So at the beginning of the script I defined array equal PLW, so I'm going to do all this operation only for PLW. Here it's a definition of the beam areas in the three cases for PMW, PLW, PSW, and then I just run the calculation.
And one question, maybe stupid, but I ask anyway, why shouldn't be the numbers reversed? Because the lowest number, 464, is for the PLW.
Yes, you are right. That's a mistake on my part. Yes, of course.
Ah, okay. Okay, then.
I will correct the script. Sorry. Yeah, you're absolutely right. Yes.
No, it was just that I don't miss anything. Just to be sure. Okay.
Yeah, the larger beam area corresponds to PLW.
Yeah,
and so now you have a map which is in Megajansky per steradiant here,
mm-hmm.
but you see that there is no offset, so that the map, if I select edit cut levels, you still see that the map is going from minus 4 to 70 Megajansky per steradiant, so it still has negative pixels. Zero offset, basically. But since I have access to the maps done with cross-calibration with Planck, I then run this next step, which is basically computing the mean, the average of the offsets from the original two observations, and it's adding the result to my output map. So now I have this other map which looks identical to the previous one, but if I now open this, you will see that the minimum value is always above zero, as you would expect, because I don't expect to have areas at minus Jansky.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah. So I did a mistake. The last part of the script is basically replicating what we just did. So to convert the original maps to Megajansky per steradiant, this time assuming that your source is a spectrum nu to the third. Again, I exchanged the values of PSW and PLW here. So this time beam areas are different, and again that's because the beam area depends on the spectral shape of your source. And if this is not clear, we may discuss it later, but I don't think we have time to do it. I don't know. But again, this is explained in the data reduction guide and the SPIRE user manual. So I'm doing exactly the same step as earlier. So I define the beam area for my map, and I use the convert image unit task to go from Jansky per beam to Megajansky per steradiant, just giving it the right beam area. Now this time the next step that you need to do is to apply a color correction, and you need to do that because of course pipeline is assuming that your source is a spectrum nu f nu equal constant, while in this case we are saying that we know that the source now has a spectrum nu to the third. And so again, these three values are taken from the table 5.6 in section 5.7 of the SPIRE data reduction guide. So I'm multiplying my map by this value. And once again, now I have a map which is computed, which is Megajansky per steradiant, which is color corrected for my source spectral shape, but which is missing the offset. So I run again this if to estimate, to add the average offset to the final map. So you will not see any difference because I just multiplied or divided my map by constants. So the map is going to be the same. The only thing that changes is here. If you remember earlier, the minimum was 0.6. Now it is 0.3. But still you see that it's above zero. And now it's just under a different source spectra assumption. So that's all for the first script. I don't know if anybody has questions.
I have one question.
Yes.
Sorry, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. For instance, the task where you're converting the image unit and you say image equals map merged. Could you also provide the error map to convert the units on the error map in that step?
It's converted automatically.
It does, okay.
Yes, it does, yeah.
So if you were to write out the I was trying to do that and then write it out with the FITS writer, and it wasn't, it didn't seem to be writing out the error portion as well. Into a multi-extension FITS file.
The map merged map as the error map, which is this one. Fair enough.
Okay. Yeah. So.
And then I open, for example, map Megajansky offset, which is Megajansky per steradiant, as you could see. Below, I don't know how to show you. And then I go to the error map. Here it's in Megajansky per steradiant. Do you see that?
Okay.
So it's there.
It is there, okay.
Yeah, so
if you were to write it out with the FITS writer, how do you get it to also write the error image?
It should be written automatically. If I say send to
really?
FITS
okay.
file, well, let me try now. For example, test.fits. So now I'm writing the Megajansky map as a FITS. Okay. And now I'm opening it with, for example, DS9. So color. And so, well, okay, that's the first layer. Now, I'm not a DS9 expert, but how do we go to the other frame?
So, DS9 by default will open just the first extension. So,
yeah, there is a way to open the other one, right?
You need to tell it.
Of course,
it
you need
you
to open it. It as a open. Let's try and open this one, I think it is.
If you open it with with IDL, for example, you can select you can see the four extensions it should get.
No, this did not work. Yes,
Or I guess it should also be in the FITS header as well, right?
So let me see the FITS header. So you see in the FITS header of the header of the first HZU, you see that at the bottom it says there are three data sets. There's a DS0, DS1, and DS2. The DS0 is the image, DS1 is the error, and DS2 is the coverage.
Where are you?
In the bottom, down to the bottom. Okay. So this means that the images are in the fits file, but DS9 by default does just show you the first extension. So I don't really know how to load the.
I remember I did it once. Now, open array. I think it's open array. No. Not this.
Open maybe multi extension data cube.
If you try with that.
Multi extension data cube. And yeah, I think here it is. You have.
Yeah. Work for me?
Just open it with data queue. It says you see one with the image and another one with the coverage map. But you don't get the.
No, I didn't get it.
You don't get the error map. We'll find this out. In theory, so there is a web page we can put in the minutes of the telecom. We have a web page with instructions on how to load these things in IDL, where you can see the three planes. Okay. And we'll investigate how to do this with DS9 as well, because you're right, it's not.
Yeah, because I have successfully opened multi-extension fits file in DS9, but the ones that I'm outputting with HIPE, I'm not able to get it. And also, usually there's a... I thought in the FITS header it would show you the different extensions that you could open separately.
Mm-hmm. But this is... No, it's not here.
So according to the FITS header, this FITS file that you save with HIPE has three extensions, because one is the image, another one is the coverage, and the other one is the error map.
Right.
But how to load it somewhere else is true is not straightforward. So we'll investigate how to do it with DS9, because you're right, I don't think we've had that documented anywhere.
Okay, thank you.
But it's not related necessarily to this convert unit function, because the FITS reader saves any simple image in the same way.
Let me take this map. So this map orig is just comes out of the observation context, so I didn't touch it. And if I say send to FITS file, let me call it test orig. And then I try to open it with DS9. Data cube. You see, it's always opening the first layer.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure it's there. I just don't remember now how you look at the other layers.
I thought it was the multi-frame thing, but I don't know.
Yeah, but that opens just the image and the coverage. Yeah. Or
in my case, it's not even asking it.
Huh.
If I say open multi-ex multi-frames, that's what you're saying.
Or may all the data cube try that?
Luca.
Yes.
In my case, you can open. One moment. That I need to. When I open multi X cube, it's working because I have another window where I can select the layer to show.
You know, maybe it's another text.
Right, another design thing pops up usually, and then you can select it.
I don't know, maybe it's related to the DS9 version. I need to check if this is the latest.
Well, no, I mean, I had the same problem, though, with the images that came out with the fifth writer. Like, normal images,
yeah.
The other window would pop up, and I could choose image, coverage, or air.
Yeah.
But the ones that I was writing with the fifth writer from HIPE 10,
yeah.
I could only get the image to come up in okay. DF9.
Yeah.
But I should try, I haven't actually tried reading them into IDL yet to see if I could open a different extension.
Yes. So we'll post in the minutes the URL where we explain how to load them in IDL. And,
okay.
And I'm gonna test offline very quickly whether that works. But in principle, so do you know if this ever happened with any previous HIPE version, or it has never worked for you?
I'm not sure. I hadn't tried it with the other HIPE version.
Yeah. Okay.
Just let me try.
Just well, that's a good point.
One more try. So this 9 here. I don't know. Okay, we'll try.
Okay, I have one more question
yeah.
that is perhaps more related to the script you just showed. I'm wondering, so if I have a bunch of dithered maps of the same field and I want to merge them all together, all the level one products, do I then, and then I want to use the timeline fitter to do photometry on the level one, will I have the timeline fitter will fit the merged level one.
Of course.
Is that right?
Yeah, of
okay.
course. Yeah. The point is,
okay.
I don't know because I've never tried to be honest. Is I'm not so sure you can save the merged level one to your. Hard drive to your local pool. So
okay.
The timeline fitter will work, but you probably need to do it on the run. So in the same HIPE session.
Okay, so like incorporate it into the merging.
But at the same time, if you have the level one, if you have the observation in your local hard drive, merging multiple level ones, it's a matter of a few seconds.
Okay.
Because it's just reading from your hard drive and putting into the same object, so it's not memory consuming.
I can't necessarily attach the level ones to any like to save them into the pool.
Yeah.
The merged. Okay.
And if it doesn't work, well, let me know and I'll investigate.
Okay.
But yes, I mean the merged level one is actually a level one, so. So it should work without any problem.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, there is another question from Simone Bianchi via the web. He says, does conversion to Megajanski's per steradian takes into account the old K for E over
no.
K for P factor?
No. No, the conversion unit is just to convert from... Jansky per beam to Jansky per pixel or mega Jansky per steradian. The other conversion is K for P over K for E. It's a kind of color correction thing. And that's in well, that's a good question. Because now with the new beam areas, it may well be that that's included in the beam area, so I need to investigate it. But originally, no. What this conversion unit task does is simply to you provide the beam area, so it's taking your map, dividing by the beam area that you provide, and multiply by if you provide. Jansky per pixel, for example, it's multiplying the map by the area of the pixel. So in this sense, it's not doing anything with the calibration.
Okay.
Okay. So I have a kind of on-the-fly demo on how you could remove glitches from your data. I don't know if anybody is interested. Otherwise, I can skip it.
I think I would. Is it
you would like to see it?
Okay. Yeah.
Okay, I'll delete all variables. So, to start over, the thing I do is open the script menu and load the bolometer finder useful script. Then what I did was to uncomment the first three lines where it's telling you example of setting up the variables. And instead of using this observation, I'm going to use the previous parallel mode observation. Since it's a parallel mode observation, I need to specify that I want the spire part of it. And the other thing that I'm going to change is the array, because I want to work on the PLW array. And so once I do that, I just double click on it and wait for the script to work. So what the script does in the first three lines, it's loading the observation from the archive, removing the median from the level one. In my case, this is not needed because I'm using the HIPE 10 level one, so it's already median removed, but in the case of other observations with HIPE 9, you would do that. And then with specifying the array PLW, I will just work on the PLW array. Then what the script does is to produce this nice, more or less nice, pop-up window. And if I zoom in and I go down into my image, you will see that over here there is this nice hot pixel, which clearly is related to a glitch. So the thing I do is to hover the mouse on it, click on it, which is not what I wanted, and what the and the result of this action is that on the right it will be shown a plot with the all detectors and their timelines that are contributing to this pixel. So you will see that basically with the legend on the right. So you would see that four detectors contributed to this to the flux of this pixel. PLW E6, B8, D3, C1. In scans ranging from the 12th scan to the 14th scan. And from the plot, you clearly see that the PLW D3 is completely out of range in respect to the other. So it's most likely this one, the one that's producing the glitch. So once you know that, basically the data that you need to mask is the PLW D3 at scan 13. So now I go back to my HIPE session. And well, my observation is stored inside the HOPS variable, so I right click on it and I select Open with Level 1 Spire Mask Editor. You wait a little bit. this opens this window, which is the mask editor tool. So we said that the affected scan is scan number 13, if I remember correctly. So you change where it says BBID, which is a building block identification number, you put number 13. And then channel, we were interested in PLW-D3. Okay. Now you see over here that in this for this scan and this detector, we have 1,614 data points. All of them have this flag voltage out of limit, but this doesn't mean that they are excluded from that. These points are excluded from the final map. However, you also see that there are 175 points detected as glitch in the first iteration. And if I select this mask bit, so you see the red dot over here, and I go to show edit, this will open a window with the timeline of PLW-D3 at this at the 13 scan. And you could see that in this region over here, the pipeline was able to detect these three data points as glitch, but it was not able to detect these other three data points as glitch. And this is clearly, this is, for example, 1.4 Jansky, so it's way higher than the baseline. So my suggestion is not to change the glitch level 1 mask, because otherwise you don't remember what you did, and you don't remember which glitches were detected by the pipeline and which you masked. So my suggestion is you close this window and you select the master bit. Whatever you include into the master bit will not go into the final map, will be excluded from all the calculation. And the nice thing is that you know that this is never set by the pipeline. So you know that you can always revert your issue, putting everything to zero if you don't like what you did. So you select this bit, you click again on show edit, and you click in selections, you click under hide. And then you select the region with the data points you want to hide. And you see that the blue crosses are changed into red crosses. Then you can close this window. And now you see that under master that six data points, six samples have been set as master. You save this mask, which has been saved, and then you can exit. So now I have a level 1 with an updated mask. The main advantage of working with data produced in HIPE, in HIPE 10, is that now I have a level 1 which is already destriped. So I don't need to rerun again the destriper, even if I change the mask at level 1. So what I do is just defining a variable level 1, which is equal to obs.level1. And this creates this new variable over here. Under my task window, I select the naive scan mapper. If it works, okay. Remember that we were working on PLW. I will not change anything else. And then I click accept. and then you wait. Okay, now you open your image, you zoom in, you go down, and you see that over here there is no hot pixel anymore, which was instead present over here. Okay, so the idea of this photometer bolometer finder script is that basically you can click anywhere in the map in any pixel, and this will tell you all the bolometers that are contributing to that pixel and for each scan. And so this is very useful if you want to identify manually and you want and you need to mask manually few glitches.
Okay, then if not, I think we should just thank Luca for the nice presentations and demos. It was very, very nice. And thanks everyone for calling. We video recorded the session and we'll post it together with the questions and answers. And then so you will be able to find a recording of this in the same page where you have the scripts and the presentations. And that's it.